first speaker for session two. He is no stranger to the legal profession or to any of us from Halsdorf. He is a unique individual who passed out of Sri Lanka Law College, having obtained first class honours in all three of his academic years, topping his batch in the final year. He was enrolled as an attorney at law in 1980. He presently holds the position of treasurer of the Colombo Law Library, which is the best law library in Sri Lanka, and also is a member of the International Bar Association. In his younger days, although he doesn't look a day older than he probably took oaths on, he was junior counsel to celebrated cases such as, the Hotel Galaxy versus Mercantile Credit case, which is often cited in the law of injunctions, and the celebrated case of Vijay Gunawardana versus Vijay Gunawardana, which is a watershed in the divorce laws of Sri Lanka. Our next speaker is currently a member of the Law Commission of Sri Lanka, having been appointed to that post by His Excellency the President. He was also appointed by His Lordship the Chief Justice as a member of the Disciplinary Committee to inquire into complaints made against lawyers, and presently he has been appointed as overall chairman of the Professional Purposes Committee appointed by the Bar Association. He was appointed by the Minister of Justice as a member of the Civil Procedure Code Amendment Committee, headed by then former Chief Justice, His Lordship Justice Prasad Depp. I have the pleasure of inviting our next speaker, Senior Attorney at Law Gigi Arulpragasam, to address us on the salient features in the Notaries and Registration of Documents Ordinance, Reconstruction of Damaged Folios, Section 35 Reporting, Foreign Bills and Resealing of Foreign Probates. Please welcome Mr. Gigi Arulpragasam.
Good afternoon, everybody. No response. Anyway. The topic or the subject I will deal with you today, salient features in the Notaries and Registration of Documents Ordinance. Every one of you, when you passed out as a lawyer, and if you have got through your conveyancing paper, you can make an application to the Ministry of Justice to get your notarial license. So the Ministry of Justice, in terms of Section 4 of the Notaries Ordinance, grant you call a warrant or the license to practice as a notary. In the license, it will be specified what judicial zone that you can act as a notary, and whatever the language that you got through to do your notarial work, you'll get either Sinhalese or English or Tamil, you get your license accordingly. Not only the lawyers, in terms of Section 4, subparagraph 3 of the Notary's Ordinance, the lawyer's clerks who have worked under a lawyer for a period of well over 2 years, as we call a clerk, as a notarial clerk, is entitled to sit for the conveyancing exam and to, once they get through the exam, to practice as a notary. When you become a notary, you are duty bound and obliged to follow to the provisions, mandated provisions of the Notary's Ordinance. The provisions are specifically set out in Section 31, subparagraph 1 to 36. Section 31, subparagraph 1 to 36, specifically sets out as a notary what and what things you are should do or duty bound to do, and what and what things you should not do. So as a notary, when you are duty bound or obliged to adhere to certain terms, if you do fail, you have to face far-reaching consequences. Those consequences are set out in Section 39, subparagraph A to G. Firstly, if there is any professional misconduct, as a first step, you may get suspended as a notary, or your notary's license can get cancelled. And the far-reaching consequences set out in Section 39, subparagraph G,
not only you get your license cancelled or suspended, you will be liable for 5 years, either simple or rigorous imprisonment. So I'm starting with that note just to see it's not an easy task to just to do a notary's work. Because most of our youngsters, they think when they do get the license, they can buy the printed form from the particular booklet, fill in the blank, send the clerk to the land registry, do a search, earn a quick buck. It's not that easy. So let's go through this note and see how far we are adhering to the mandatory obligations and the duties under the notary's ordinance. Kindly see in my note, section 31, subparagraph 9. I'm not going to read the note in verbatim, but I will emphasize what is needed for you to learn. Section 31, subparagraph 9, I'll read from the note. He shall not authenticate or attest any deed or instrument unless, I emphasize the word, unless the person executing the same be known to him or to at least two of the attesting witnesses thereto. Now the question I'll pose to you, are we adhering to that? Being in practice for 39 years, I can say without any kind of a doubt, we hardly practice this. Of course, I do understand when you do pass out as a lawyer, and also when you become a notary, no client is going to walk into your office and say, look, I'm going to do a deed, will you execute? Because at times, that may be the entire life saving of a person, they are investing on a property. So they won't come to an unknown person. So obviously, someone will introduce you, a client. So when a client got introduced, virtually we call it executed in terms of this will document. So when a client is introduced, okay, the section 31 subparagraph 9 empowers that kind of a situation. You can do a deed. Yes. So what should you do when an X is introducing you to the Y? You must tell X, I don't know who this gentleman is. Then you must get a person who knows the another witness who is known to that person. Then when you do execute the deed of that nature, in the attestation, you have to specifically state, executor is not known to me. The executor is said to be known to the two witnesses. And that's how we have to do. But what are we doing in practice? All what we do, if you look at 99.99 in the notary's offices, they get their respective clerks or the peons to sign as witnesses. And they take the cover and they say, executor is not known to me, said to be known to two witnesses. And the resulting position, in the event of any problem, you get escape, that other two poor people will get into difficulty. My good friend, Mr. Naveel Labiratna here, I think we are doing a case, I have just referred to him, interesting case. Wife was out of the country, husband forged wife's signature and transferred the property to the wife, to himself and to the children. It happened 20 years ago. Notary is dead and gone. Wife came back from abroad, went to the fraud bureau, made a complaint. Now, notary is gone 6 feet under, escaped. Now, the innocent two witnesses who can't remember anything being charged. So, next week we have to defend. So, look at the plight that we are, but what the notaries are doing. So, under section 31, subparagraph 9, you are duty bound, obliged to adhere that. And specifically it says, I read it again, he shall not authenticate or attest any deed or instrument unless the person executing the same be known to him or at least two of the attesting witnesses there. And in the latter case, then I'm not going to read the rest of it, it's not that relevant. So the important ingredient is when you're executing a deed, you should know at least one party, either the executor or the two witnesses. If you know the executor, you must specifically say, executor is known to me in the attestation. Now, next one. 31 subparagraph 10. He shall not authenticate or attest any deed or instrument in any case in which both persons executed the same and the attesting witnesses there are unknown to. So, if you don't know, you should not execute. Now, the most crucial thing, he shall not, next one, 31 paragraph 12. he shall not authenticate or attest any deed or instrument unless the person executing the same and the witnesses shall have signed the same in his presence and the in the presence of one another, unless he shall have signed the same in the presence of executing of the attesting witnesses. This is a, as I think Shyam was mentioning about the disciplinary committee overall chairman, I received for a week well over 15 complaints based on this. At least 15 complaints on the notaries mainly. Now what does it say? When you execute the deed, all have to be together simultaneously. Now take for example execution of a last will, or maybe executing a deed, somebody's bedridden. What have you got to do? So when you are asked to execute a deed of that nature, assume for a moment if the person is there, first of all the mental condition of that person you must ascertain. And safer thing to do is to get the two doctors to certify and to say this particular person is in a proper, stable mental condition to sign the deed. Back again, I think, you may be wondering why I am mentioning again and again, Neville, another case. Back again, we are defending a notary. A lady was in a coma stage. The doctors have a particular person now who has complained against this particular execution of a document. His position was the person who signed the so-called alleged document was in coma at least a couple of weeks prior to the execution of the deed. Now action has been filed against the notary. Notary was taken into custody, produced in court, now on bail. The problem there is the witnesses, as the two witnesses who signed was never there. The document has been taken, gone, got the signature, and the doctors say this can't be an act and deed of this particular lady. Why? She was in coma. To prove that fact, now they are showing the bed date ticket and the doctor coming forward giving evidence. Hope and pray we will defend and get the person out. If the person is innocent, that's the court has to decide. So this is the problem. Especially in regard to last wills, ensure the mental condition of the person. Because the safer thing to do is get a doctor to certify that the mental condition of the person is in good standing, that's in a good position, and manage to get the signature. If the person is in a proper, correct state to understand what the person is doing. So section 31, subparagraph 12 categorically says, he shall not authenticate, attest any deed, instrument, unless the person executing same and witness shall have signed the same in the presence of one and another, unless shall have signed the same in the presence of the other. Section 31, subparagraph 12. Now the next section is 31, subparagraph 70. Before any deed or instrument other than a will or codicil affecting any interest in land or other movable properties drawn by him, he shall search or cause to be searched the registry of the land registry to ascertain state or title in regard to whether prior to the deed affecting there. So this is another issue. What if most of the notaries, what do they do? Even so-called big firms, I'm telling you with responsibility, they send the clerk, not even applying for the extracts. So get the deed, get the search note, execute the deed. No search done. The clients are coming and entrusting the valuable property to be written, paying their hard-earned money not to send your clerk and do the search. You have to go personally. That is your obligation and the duty cast on a notary. So we send, most of them send a note clerk, and that person, he is bound to miss cross-reference in the extracts. He is bound to miss caveats. He is bound to miss, there can be list pending. And furthermore, the other problem that can happen is, now say for example, you get a search to be done today, maybe in month of, say 8th of February. You execute the deed in April. From today to April, many things can happen. Ensure the day that you are signing the deed to get the last extract. I have more than the notes, I have a lot of stories to tell. I think the stories will be very useful. A well-known, reputed firm head. He was selling a house, I don't want to mention the name, and the property there. they parted with this deed with another lawyer. I'm extremely sorry to say, today most of the lawyers are real estate agents or they are brokers. Nothing wrong as long as they do their profession properly. But they are indulging in all sort of activity with the consent and the collusion of the land register. That's the problem. So in coming back to this story, whatever the very valuable property down Skeleton Road, the deeds were handed over by the senior partner of the firm to another lawyer, say. The owner at that time was in England. So then the particular person who interested to purchase, another firm, very senior attorney, she went to land registry to do a search and she found the property has been already sold and there is an entry. Then immediately they contacted the person. He said, what are you talking? I'm in England. I'm not here. I didn't come for the last 6 months. He said, no, your lawyer gave me the deed saying that you are selling the property. Property sold and I managed to get an extract. So extract was obtained. I worked under that senior and then therefore they came and consulted me. I said, all right. First of all, protect the property, put some security because somebody may walk in and take over, put some security, so security was put there. So what I did is when I went to check the land registry, I found the last entry, there is a carried over folio erased. There is nothing available in the land registry. Fortunately, the other senior lawyer of that firm has obtained the extract. So I managed to get the extract. I complained to the registrar too, nothing happened. Immediately, very unusual thing, I filed action against the notary, against the lawyer to whom we gave the deed, and the person who was involved as a broker. Got the enjoining order, restraining them selling, transferring, mortgage property. The note, during the vacation, vote on once, the particular judge was very, very unhappy the way I have named the people. He said, Mr. Arulpragasam, I can understand you filed action to set aside the deed. Why did you make these people a party? You have made a party who collected the deed. You have made the party notary who did the deed. You have made the party who, the judge, this is very serious issue and I explained to him who, that particular client, person whose property was sold. Apparently the judge too has worked in that firm. So he took some interest on the matter. Very first day, summons returnable date, this person came and told, this is not act of deed of mine. Somebody appeared. So when that person appeared, I told, can this matter maybe call a little later because I need to check his identity card whether he is the same notary. Because somebody coming forward, normally when a person comes before court and say, I am the notary you attested, you don't check the identity of the person. Because it can be a wrong impersonation. So I took the identity of the particular person, checked with the bar association whether he is still a member of the bar association. Yes, he happened to be a member who has never sent a duplicate in his life. When a young notary don't send the monthly list, immediately let us come. So anyway, so what happened end of the day? Court, first day, deed was set aside because he said he's not accurate. First day, we got the judgment in favor of the person whom I worked. So be very cautious in regard to section 31, subparagraph 17a. By any deed or instrument affecting in that. So you have to do the search by yourself. Don't get any other person to do. As I told you, the clients are coming and paying the hard-earned money for you to do the work. Because you have a name, you have a reputation. They are paying a price for you. Not for you to send your clerk and to make a quick buck. So most important thing is, you have to ensure that standards be maintained. The next one is section 31, subparagraph B. The first line is not needed. Second, say, provided if the parties to the transaction authorize notary in writing to dispense with the search shall not be compulsory, he shall before the deed. Now, there are instances. Now, say, for example, you are a notary in Colombo, somebody wants to get a deed situated in Jaffna written, and you say, look, I can't go to Jaffna, I can't do a search. Then he said, no problem, sir, this is from me to so and so to a gift. So, even if it is a deed of gift, you have to do a search to see whether that person is owning the property to gift. How do you know whether it has been gifted to somebody else? So you have to check it. But there are instances, as notaries we face, clients give specific instruction to say, you need not do a search. So for that, in that kind of a situation, notary's ordinance permits, section 13, subparagraph 17, where you can specifically put on the deed on the top, search dispense with. So you are not done. I advise you to go a step further. Get a letter from the person, your client who is giving instruction to do the deed, that on my instruction, no search was done on this. Because if something goes wrong, even though that search dispense note is there, you can be liable. You can be liable. So if you, in addition to putting on the deed on the top of it, search dispense with, it is always advisable to get a letter from a particular client to say, I have requested him not to do a search and accordingly no search is done. Why? If somebody else looking at after the registration of the deed, looked at the deed, they know very well, no, this is not a proper deed, this has not been properly checked. So the next buyer or the next notary who is executing the deed will take precaution to look into the matter further than normal. Yeah. Now, another important thing, section 31, subparagraph 8. He shall correctly insert in letters in every deed or instrument executed before him a day, month, year, and the place where the same is executed shall sign the same. Now, when you execute a deed, very often what happens, sometimes these clients come and don't give them money, stamp duty. Yeah. So we don't put the proper date, that one instance. There are some instances for your convenience, you may say, the client will come and say, so I'm signing today, but date for such and such a day, because today is maybe not a good day. So, you know, just to adhere to the client, you just accommodate. You should never do that. If a deed is executed, it has to be dated that particular day. There again, I'll tell you another case I handled. A particular client gave a power of attorney to another colleague to sell the property. After he gave the power of attorney to sell the property, property was sold. In regard to the sale consideration, there was a dispute between a principal and the attorney. And attorney filed action, saying that this is not act and deed of mine. His signature. What happened? The real position was the notary did not put the exact day when it was signed. The day he signed, very same night he left the country. And it had been signed on a Friday, it had been dated on Monday. And he got the passport. That's his signature. He managed to get the passport and to show court, this is not act and this deed. That entire transaction became nullity. Notary got into difficulty. The bona fide purchaser got into difficulty. Of course, they should have, a case was handled badly. They could have gone for an EQD and prove that it is signature. Of course, at least the notary could have given explanation and say he made a mistake. And he also took a high ground. He doesn't want to admit that he made a mistake. Result, the position is A, the transaction got set aside. B, the notaries got into difficulty, and now the bona fide purchaser is struggling to get the money that he has paid. Merely because of being careless, not putting the same date. If you look at these notaries, all is very simple. Don't know, do this, do that. But consequences are far-reaching. As I started at the beginning, youngsters think they can buy the printed form from the particular boutique there, fill in the blanks, put the thing, 2% of the sale consideration, 1% good money. And end of the day, they'll give some zero amount to a particular clerk who is doing the work. It was lux way. Right. Now, that is section 31, subparagraph 18. I'm just explaining the value of a particular date. Then section 31, subparagraph 20, he shall, without delay, duly attest every deed instrument, which he shall execute to acknowledge before him, shall sign seal. The said deed instrument was signed by the party and the witness thereto in the presence of another. I explained to you earlier. Whether the person executing or acknowledging said deed or instrument or attesting witness thereto, known to him there, the day, month, I explained, who shall think? Whether the same was read over by the person executing the same or read and explained by him, the said notary to the person in the person of attesting. Now, this is another one, lot of complaints are coming. Now, when the complaints are coming in, it's so easy for me, the client, these particular complainants are so familiar with the notary. I don't think any one of you, after you got through the exam, ever read section 31, subparagraph 1 to 36. Most of you all got through, including me. Now I am going through because I am in the disciplinary panel, because otherwise we also won't read. Clients are very familiar. having made the complaint, specifically says this particular lawyer violated section 31, subparagraph such and such, and I am requesting you, the chairman of the committee, take action again. The section is quoted. Like few months ago, I think almost all the citizens in this country knew the 19th Amendment, section 70, when the parliament can dissolve. Similarly, now these clients who are complaining, they have the notary's ordinance in their hand. They set out the section to me and said, take steps on this section. So my task was very simple. I need not look into it. I know what section there. So important thing is, you have to, in terms of section 31, subparagraph 20D, explain. Now say, for example, lot of complaint. Now you are a notary doing the deed in English land. A village man, some person, or maybe a Saranjoni, maybe a Sampu, he can't understand a word of English. Then you must set out how, whether you explain. Or a Tamil person, what language you explain? And very often complaints are made. He said, got my signature to a particular document, I never knew what I was signing, I never understood. So ensure that is read over and explained. Of course, HNB, my good friend, is here. I'm not referring to that bank, but I must make specific reference. Most of the bank, not that bank, I think the chairman of the committee will also end up. When they get this mortgage bond signed, they smuggle in section 47 name, never explain. Most of the banks. I'm telling you, with responsibility, I'm telling you. When I have gone for the execution of the thing, he said, what is this document? Why aren't you explaining to the client? What is the 47A declaration? In the event of you default, it's not only the property that you mortgage, even the property not mortgage, they are caught up. Most of the bank, I'm sorry to say, I have experienced it there. So that's completely wrong. And there are instances where people have filed action to set aside the debt on that basis. Then that is section 31 of paragraph 20E. Then the number and the value of the adhesive stamp affixed to the value. That. Now this is another issue in regard to the stamping. Sorry to say, earlier we had a situation where when you do, say if we do a deed for the month of, from 1st of February till 8th of February, we can send our monthly so on the 15th. So what do? We roll the money for 1.5 months. Because of this rolling and not sending the paying the stamp duty, now they have got a very stringent procedure, confining only for within 1 week. So within 7 days that you have to pay the stamp duty. And there are still certain notaries play out the stamp duty. And I think, I don't want to mention the name, a well-known firm, a legal officer, execute mortgage bond. This particular company gives a lot of loans. When they give the loan, the mortgages are short-term loans. Say for example, 1 month, 2 months, then they get the mortgage cancelled. So what happened, this particular notary, acting with a collusion with another director, running into couple of million. Now for a month, they do about 200 to 300 million worth loan, facility service. So what this person is doing is, do the mortgage, get the signature, and when hardly anyone will go to court, why? Within a month or before the bond goes and registered and come back, etc. So they don't have. One particular case where Ratnapur, a gem merchant, did not make the payment. And he disputed, he wanted a copy of the bond. This particular legal officer, very senior person, without any hesitation, gave a number. He went to the land registry, get a copy of the duplicate, and found last 40 to 45 deeds, all are last wills. All last wills. No mortgage has been done. And then what happened? Person was prosecuted. I don't know what happened in the High Court. Indictment was served, and I don't know what happened subsequently. Now this is the problem. So some of those people take the stamp duty and play. And that is the very reason the legislation thought, no, we should not give the lever to the lawyers to play the money for 1.5 months. Now, within 7 days from the date of the execution, you have to pay the stamp duty. That's mandatory. Then, this is very crucial. Paragraph G, specifically the erasers, alteration, interpolation which have been made in such deed or instrument, whether they were made before the same was read over or said erased there. Now very often this happens. Now say when we do a deed, we can make a mistake. So if we do make a mistake, we have to show in the attestation what is the mistake, whether it's erased, interpolator or alter, we have to put that on there. And very often, what we do is, we do the deed, send the duplicate, don't think that the other side will be smart, and thereafter to suit your convenience, then you do the modification. There's one instance where, when the husband and wife were no issue at all and they were living together, husband gifted the property to the wife, absolute irrevocable. No problem, things went on well. Then the divorce action was filed. And that's the house where the wife was living. I was appearing for the wife. Then when the document was brought in, I found that particular making use of those, I think Navila Viratna will deal with those revocation of gift, making use of the provisions of the revocation at that time. Suddenly we found it with the divorce case, he's asking for an order to chase my client out of the house on the basis that the gift has been revoked. Just to tell you the back again, husband gifted the property to the wife, there. They living together, wife was not even bothered to get a copy of the deed and living, no issue at all. Then suddenly something went wrong, third party came into the scene, so husband filed action and divorce papers are served. In the divorce papers, one of the prayers he is asking to get this lady out of the matrimonial home. So when this lady came, I told her, asked her, then he said, no sir, this particular property was absolutely irrevocably given. This was not the deed, I could remember, I signed it, it was never there, this revocation part was not there. Now, property has been given, absolutely irrevocable, subsequently in the original it has been altered and cancellation has been done, registered in the land register. This lady had no reason to check it because they were living together and she didn't even ask for a copy of the deed. So I told, alright, we have to file our answers now, get in. I did a search in the land register and applied for a copy from the duplicate without any alteration. Duplicate says absolute irrevocable. Original, erase, put it in the attestation, read out here, there, the complete. So even when they, I'm not telling you to do any jugglery, they don't know even to do a jugglery. Now see, he did the thing in the original, forgot to do the thing with the duplicate. So entire thing was set aside. We succeeded the case. And notary also got into, as usual, as I told you there, notary got into problem. So there are instances where you may make mistake. If you do make a mistake, be humble. Go and tell the register, it has happened to me. We go and tell the register, look, this mistake is there, here is the original. In front of the register, you can correct. There are provisions, we can do that. There are no problem at all. But don't ever do juggling. Very often, now you act for a particular client. After the client leaves, then the particular client says, no, I'll pay you more, can you do this? Don't ever do. Like the attorneys at law, noble profession, this is a noble profession. The clients are not coming and entrusting us to do this kind of juggling. So section 31, subparagraph G, specifically, erasers, alteration, interpolation, which have been made in such deed or instrument, whether they were made before the same red or first deed, erasers, or if you have done any kind of a thing of that sort, timely put in the attestation. The in page number such and such, this was erased, this was altered, then there is nothing wrong. Much as possible, better not to do anything. But if you are compelled to do something, show in the attestation. And also ensure it's done in all three, original, duplicate, protocol. As I told you the example, where all alterations are in the original, deed is duly registered, the land registry entry shows avalam kirime aithi adatva, but if you look at the origin, the duplicate, other way. Absolutely wrong. Then, the attestation, most of the people are used to do is wrong. You have, in regard to the consideration, when you talk about the consideration, very often clients give instruction to us and say, sir or madam, the money was paid. So if it was paid, say in the attestation what exactly took place. If it was paid, don't ever take the responsibility of client's word and say, paid in my presence. Because you will get into difficulty. Because never transacted. How? Was it by cash? Was it by check? Was it by pay order? You must say. You don't say that. So client said to you, he said, no, the said transaction took place in front of me, in the presence of me. It's very dangerous. So say exactly what occurred. If the money was said to be, if the client says money was paid, say in the attestation, the consideration was paid prior to the execution. You have no responsibility. prior to the execution. If it was paid by cash, by cash. If it's paid by check, check. Don't ever put post-dated checks. There are some attestation I see post-dated checks. No, there's no proper transaction. You can't say with a future effect, with a, those checks get bounced. You can't put on the attestation post-dated. Section 31, subparagraph 26A, I need not go through this, you have to give the monthly list there. Then in section 31, subsection 26.2, say outstation copies you have to send. And section 31, subparagraph 26B says, where if you are out of the country, even if you have not done a single deed, then you have to send the nil list if you are out of the country. I'll only read with section 39 there. Now this is very, very crucial. People are unaware what serious repercussion can. Section 39G, A to G, if any notary shall attest any fraudulent deed, knowing same to be fraudulent, or shall knowingly, willfully, with intent to prejudice, defraud any person, insert anything. So these are the clauses given where you have to face far-reaching consequences. Page 5, I have given those cases, number of cases, where the notary's license got cancelled, got stuck off, and went to jail. The next one, page 6. Salient features in the registration documents are in caveat. Caveat, the word came, called caveat emptor. It's a Latin term. Buyer must be aware. What do you mean by buyer must be aware? So, if somebody put a caveat in the deed, the meaning is be cautious. So, in short, we have to presume somebody has an interest in the land, and that is the very reason he has put a caveat. So, caveat means caveat emptor, buyer must be aware. Now, this particular section 32, subparagraph 1, has been misused to the hilt. Everybody, every Dick, Tom, and Harry now putting caveat. Now, why these problems are starting? They're starting because of the negligence of a notary. Now, say for example, if a property is for sale, if you are acting for a seller or buyer, now say for example, seller. If you are acting for a seller, client, say buyer's lawyer is asking for a copy of the deed. What you should do, you must tell the buyer's lawyer, send me a letter saying that I write on the instructions of my client is so and so, and kindly send me the copy of the deed. And specifically you have to say, you should hold same at my disposal. Then you reply back and say, here's your deed. What do? We give the deed, they don't, very often, no lawyers are acting. Who is acting? So-called brokers. If transaction fails, the broker goes and land a caveat. Very valuable property. You just put up. The reason is the problem in this act, section 32, subparagraph 1, doesn't define who can put a caveat. Any person may present for the registration of caveat, prescribed form, required to be served. So, anybody can put a caveat. The meaning is for you to put a caveat, you must have an interest in the land. You have no interest in the land. Broker can't have any interest in the land. So the problem is, and also look at the far-reaching consequences. Now, I know a particular instance where a property to be sold for about 500 million. Parties dealt with through a broker, and finally they couldn't, because the process is very high. Once a caveat is landed, what is the procedure? You have to follow a summary procedure. You file petition and affidavit. You get an order nisi. Once you get the order nisi, you served on the other side. They will file paper. Assume for an order nisi is get vacated, appeal, civil appeal, like going to the civil appeal, from civil appeal, another couple of years, then to the Supreme Court. They will feel it's rather better to give a couple of million to that broker and get it. So you are in a very lux way. You can kind of put a caveat, you are settled for life. So caveat means if a person who has some interest in the land, only you can. So due to these drawbacks and the lacuna in the law, I'm a member of the Law Commission, I have suggested a couple of amendments to the caveats. Now very soon it will come up, headed by Mr. Ramesh Sivan, we are drafting the paper. I have set the proposed amendments, I have set out here, page 7, I have said who, now we are specifying or giving the interpreting the person who can put a caveat. Section 32, subparagraph 1 in page 7 says, registration documents on caveat and property can be lodged by any person other than the lodge there. Now, this misuse, and therefore now we are taking the measures. The first measure is, far comprehensive and specific definition being given to a person who can file a caveat. So now we are describing or giving the definition, who can be a KVO? A person who has an interest in the land. It can be wife, it can be husband, it can be heir, kith and kin, we are equivalent. Of course, having said that, we also say, no sooner than as the law stands today, you put a caveat. Now, when you get to know about the caveat, when a property be sold or some transaction, it's lying for years and years. You don't know in your property, a man who has never seen the color, you don't know Adam or Eve, who is this person, a caveat. Somebody is blocking your own property to be sold. And now it has become a joke. The real owners, to protect their interest, they are putting caveat. Everybody is putting a caveat. Why? If there is anything, any forgery happening, I will get to know that separately. So dangerous. Even your own property is not safe. So now, to prevent those abuse, we have now introduced new thing. First of all, we have said, define section 32, subparagraph 1, a broader definition, who can be a caveator. We are narrowing and limiting who is the person. Second one, no sooner the caveat is lodged, immediately notify the person. You can't just land a caveat and keep on somebody's property. Number three, we are introducing a provision because I'm sorry to say most of these malpractices are done by us, notaries. We are party to it. And most of the now latest trend is caveats are done by lawyers at the instructions of clients. So therefore, we have put a lot of debate on this in the law commission, of course. Hard attitudes taken by Germany, said no, this should be there. We are now, before the caveat being presented, we have to get a declaration from the notary to say this person is a person falling within the ambit or the scope of that caveat, and he has to certify. We put in the responsibility of the lawyers. Because they are the people, we are here to protect the law. We are the very same people who are violating the law. So then, that's why I said in paragraph 3, introducing provision which outlines the specific format which is to be followed when filing a caveat, verify statutory declaration which is to be tendered in the caveat. A verify statutory declaration signed by the attorney as well as the caveator, setting on what interest that is falling into. Then also, if he has done a caveat fraudulently, without any right, without any interest, he will be liable for damages. Then the other issue is, assume for a moment, okay, a caveat is filed, rightly or wrongly. Now we are giving provisions in terms of the new act to get interim orders, where if he can go satisfy court on the as at now, there is no law. The law is you simply file a summary action, serve my side, other side file papers, then inquiry will go through, maybe get absolute, may get vacated, then appeal, civil appeal, Supreme Court, couple of years ago. Under the new section, if you do have a good ground to set aside, no sooner you are notified by the land registry, immediately you file papers and get an interim order set aside. And even partly, now say for example, if two people put a caveat, if one person is removing, then to that effect, we can get the orders to set aside there. Resealing of foreign probate. That's, I think, very unusual. But, okay. And also the other one is, reconstructed damaged folios. Now see, very often what happens is, now when we go to land registry and in regard to a folio, now say for example, there is an entry in 1950 or 60 and the next entry is in 2017. So during that period there, when the people over and over again doing the search on the same property, either it can get damaged or it can get perished. And therefore now there is a new section, it's already in the thing there. Land registry has already now commenced the process doing the reconstruction as set out there. It is set out in section 40 of the registration documents ordinance and there. Then I'm dealing with the resealing of foreign probate, the last one. The resealing of foreign probate is, it's quite an unusual one. Now if a Sri Lankan who is living abroad execute a power of attorney, execute a last will in that country in regard to a property situated in Sri Lanka, executed in England or whatever the country, you can't come to Sri Lanka and prove the will. Why? The notaries in that country, witness are in its country, executed on that country, so you can't. So what do you do? So what you have to do is, in regard to the said last will, we call a foreign last will, that last will has to be proved in the foreign country. So what you do is, you institute action in that country and get the foreign probate. So even though if you get a foreign probate, now the next question arrives, will our country recognize the foreign probate? Answer is no. So what have we got to do? So we have to go through the process. Of course, when a will is proved in a foreign country and a probate is granted, there is no necessity to go through the protracted thing, what is set out in section 524, subparagraph 1, what we do as at now, when a person died with a will, you have to file action, then it has to be published twice in the newspaper, there are at least, even in uncontested case, it takes about 6 months, all those protracted procedures not needed. All what you have to do is, if you have a foreign probate with you, in terms of section 554, subparagraph U of the Civil Procedure Code, what you have to do is, no sooner you get the foreign probate, with a motion, you tender the foreign probate to court and tell, inform court, this particular person died in whatever the country, here is the foreign probate, grant permission to publish same in the newspapers, English, Sinhala and Tamil. So once it is published in the newspaper, we will say in the notice, if within 28 days, no steps have been taken to object, then the foreign probate will be received. So upon, first step is, when you have a foreign probate, number one, under 554U of the Civil Procedure Code, you get the foreign probate, file a motion, and with a motion and with a probate, action commence. Once the action commence, when the court grant the permission for you to publish the notice in the paper, in the notice, you categorically, clearly say, within 28 days, there is any objection that has to be come forward. So within 28 days, there are no objection, you file a petition, an affidavit in court, and say, so-and-so died, leaving a will in such and such a country. The will was proved in that country, foreign probate was granted, and foreign probate has been now, the notice has been published in the newspapers, here are the newspapers, I am requesting court to receive. Without going through any hassle, court will grant the receiving. So once the receiving is granted, the normal procedure, you follow the inventory, final account, and at one shot, the proceedings will be terminated. Once it has happened, it will be good as a probate issued in our country. So that's all, I don't take time, and kindly read the, I am not going to repeat it, kindly read the last two sentences in the note, my note, and please adhere and follow in addition to section 31, subparagraph 1 to 36, and also I think that covered in my last two sentences in my note. Thank you for your patience.